Good noon. Today we have the lectures of translation. Translation means protein synthesis. Here we will start first with a small video.
In order for our bodies to function, we need to supply them with a
Please see and concentrate on video.
Digestion uses different proteins and enzymes to break down the food particles into usable nutrients our cells can absorb. And where are the instructions to...
This is a cell. This is a nucleus. This is a DNA.
DNA contains genes. A gene is a continuous string of nucleotides containing a region that codes for an RNA molecule.
This is initiation with the transcription.
Near the promoter or at a more distant location. For some genes, the encoded RNA is used to synthesize a protein in a process called gene expression.
Translation. This is mRNA formation.
Used as a template to make messenger RNA. Then in translation, which occurs in the cytoplasm of the cell, the information.
This is a translation. How the protein synthesis is done.
Polypeptide. During transcription, the DNA in the gene is used as a template to make a messenger RNA strand. With the help of the enzyme,
we have completed the transcription
and is performed by a complex made up of
this is a spliceosome
called a splice.
And they will make the mature mRNA.
This complex removes the intron segments and joins the adjacent exons to produce a mature messenger RNA strand that can
this is a mature RNA. Now the translation starts
to begin translation.
Now this is a translation. In a translation, there are first, please see the basic stage, then concentrate on the initiation and elongation factor. First, do not worry about the initiation and elongation factor.
Translated into a protein.
This is mRNA.
Nitrogenous bases are grouped into three letter codes called codons.
This is a codon.
The genetic code includes 64 codons. Most codons.
You already know this is a genetic code.
There are four special codons. One that codes for start and three that code for stop.
Start and the stop codon.
Begins with the messenger RNA strand binding to the small ribosomal subunit upstream of the start codon. Each amino acid is brought to the ribosome.
Now the tRNA will take each amino acid parallel to the mRNA.
The large ribosomal subunit binds to form the translation complex, and initiation is complete.
This is the initiation complete. The first, the methionine tRNA is there.
Called the E, P, and A sites. During elongation, individual amino acids are brought to the messenger RNA strand.
Now this is a protein synthesis.
The complex slides down one codon to the right, where the now uncharged transfer RNA molecule exits from the E site, and the A site is open.
until a stop codon is reached. This is the elongation step. A release factor binds to the ACE. Now this is the termination stage. And the polypeptide is released from the transfer RNA in the P site. The entire complex dissociates and can reassemble to begin the process again. Now the translation is complete and the protein synthesis has been completed. The polypeptide may need to be modified before it is ready to function. Modifications take place in different... Okay, so this is regarding translation. The post-translational modification is a part of the protein synthesis, but it will be taken after the translation. Now, in a translation, first thing that all the RNAs are taking part. Initiation, the mRNA attaches to the ribosome, rRNA. The tRNA attaches to the free amino acid, and it will take parallel to the mRNA, it will take regarding particular amino acid, and that amino acid are hooked together and they will make the protein synthesis. In a translation, there are the start codon and the stop codon. The start signal is always AUG, and stop codons are UAA, UAG and UGA. But please make it sure that UGA is a code also for the selenocysteine, and the UAG is also code for the pyrrolocysteine. The initiation with the initiation factor. The next is a translocation step where the one amino acid of the one tRNA is transferred to the another tRNA. Just fill concentrate on a figure only. The third is a termination stage where the releasing factor will come. So whenever you are going to make a prepare the translation, just be make it sure, do not concentrate on the all factors, initiation factor, elongation factor. Second, do not concentrate on GTP and the energy requirement. Okay, so you can easily go and get it, what is the translation. But once you know the basic, then you can again read only for a factors only, and third time only for a energy process. Okay, so you can know the translation easily, otherwise there is a all mix up. There are the two terms. The one is a translation in a cytoplasm at ribosome. The another is a gene expression. Gene expression is called as a collectively transcription and translation. They will get whatever the gene from DNA to the protein synthesis. So it is called as a gene expression. There are total three types of RNA: ribosomal RNA, transfer RNA and the messenger RNA. In a ribosomal RNA, there are the various subunit. This is the basic that first from DNA pre-mRNA is made up. Now the pre-mRNA or hnRNA is converted into mature mRNA. Here the introns are relieved and exon are joined. And on the mRNA there is a 5' capping and the 3' poly A tail. And they will come to the cytoplasm. It is going to be the saved and it is come to the cytoplasm. In a cytoplasm, parallel to mRNA, the tRNA will make particular amino acid, and amino acid will hook and make the particular proteins. This is the same thing, but in detail, that AUG is a start codon. Okay, the coding sequence is on mRNA in a particular region, and that region will make the protein. This is a protein mRNA, and mRNA there is a particular protein sequence is there where it starts with the AUG. Okay, and from AUG, the few steps upwards there is a initiation sequence is there. Now this is regarding 3 RNA. The inner translation, one thing is there, all the RNA, ribosomal RNA, mRNA and tRNA, all three will take part equal in a process. Here in prokaryotes there are 23, 16 and 5S unit. In eukaryote 28, 18, 5.8 and 5S various subunit. They have the Swedberg unit. S is for the Swedberg unit. This is for MCQ purpose. The ribosomal RNA is for a protein synthesis and catalyzes the RNA to itself, then it called as ribozyme. Here, if there is a target RNA is there and ribozyme is there, then it will make the particular parallel to the target RNA and it will cleave it. So, ribozyme will act this way. Ribozyme, peptidyl transferase is one of the ribozyme. The tRNA has a clover leaf structure. tRNA has the various arm, T-psi, CA loop, anticodon arm, D loop is there, and the 3-days end. In a 3-days end, there is a finally CCA, site of amino acid sequence is there. Here, there is near about 70 to 95 nucleotide base pair will make tRNA. This is a 3-dimensional structure of the tRNA. tRNA is the smallest one, 73 to 93 base pair nucleotide, easily soluble, so it is also called as the soluble RNA, sRNA. A specific tRNA for the all 20 amino acid. Each amino acid has its own tRNA, clover leaf structure. Here the various arm are there, dihydrouracil arm recognize enzyme to add the amino acid, pseudouridine arm, the DYC arm, binding tRNA to the ribosome, DYC arm. The DM recognize particular enzyme to add the amino acid. The anticodon arm recognize the triplet codon on the mRNA so that the according to mRNA, anticodon have the tRNA, they will make the particular amino acid which are on the mRNA, not according to anticodon. And the acceptor arm, CCA arm, 3-days end arm, it will carry the amino acid. Translation, the various steps are there, initiation, elongation, termination, and the post-translational modification. Here, the translation machinery is, the figure shows, the black one which is behind, it is a ribosome, ribosomal large subunit and the small subunit, rRNA. The red one, just like as a rope, it is a mRNA. The green, yellow and the pink boxes, they are the particular side, and the hook shape is a tRNA, and the magenta color, the violet color, it is a particular amino acid which will tRNA take from a cytoplasm and come to the parallel to the mRNA. So this is the basic requirement, and the one enzyme is there, peptidyl transferase. It is between the activated amino acid and they will join together and will make the protein synthesis. So the translation process, the basic machinery required are ribosome 50S, large subunit or 30S, rRNA, tRNA, mRNA and the amino acid. If you have this basic one, then you can make the translation process. In prokaryote, there is a 70S subunit which is made up of 50S and 30S, and in eukaryotes, there is a 80S subunit which is made up of 60S, large subunit and 40S, small subunit. Initiation, elongation and the termination. Initiation, the ribosomal subunit assemble on mRNA, the large subunit and the small subunit will make. Elongation, the P, A and the E site, the tRNA will make the come to the particular amino acid and they will make the protein synthesis. And finally, whenever the stops codon are there, at that time there is a termination. This is a ribosome. On ribosome, there are total 3 sites. E site is not shown here, but it is just before the P site. Whenever there is a complete the function of P site, at that time that will go to the E site. Okay, and whenever the new amino acid will come, it will come to the A site. Okay, and the basic one, the lower one is a small subunit, the upper one is a large subunit. P site is a peptidyl tRNA. This tRNA carries the chain of the amino acid, has been already synthesized. The A site is a amino acid tRNA, the new amino acid, where new tRNA will come to the A site. and specific to the next amino acid. This is just parallel. The tRNA has an anticodon, but it will take particular UCG, that is for the particular is for serine. So the serine will attach to the CCAM. Amino acyl tRNA synthetase, this is the enzyme which will activate the amino acid. The amino acid will join to the tRNA with the enzyme amino acyl tRNA synthetase. Regarding this enzyme, it is a very extremely specific, and please concentrate on the equation. Amino acid plus tRNA plus ATP will make the amino acyl tRNA plus AMP. So total two phosphate bond are used here, and it will activate the amino acyl tRNA. This is amino acyl tRNA complex is formed. It is a very specific, and it is highly specific in such a that way that the word is high fidelity enzyme. If anyone is going to you ask in a PG examination that which one is of the following is a high fidelity enzyme in the whole body, the first answer is amino acyl tRNA. So it is a very particular complex, so that amino acyl tRNA synthetase, they will make particular amino acid, means it has too much specificity, too much sensitivity, that it will do not have very less chances of mistake, and it will take particular amino acid and particular amino acid joined with the particular tRNA. Please concentrate high fidelity of the translation. Here it is a schematic representation how the tRNA and amino acid are activated. The tRNA joined at the amino acyl tRNA complex, yellow one. The amino acid in a purple one, it will join at the another complex. Now the amino acyl tRNA synthetase will catalyze activity, and it will make the amino acyl tRNA complex. This tRNA and amino acyl acid, they will go to the particular parallel to the mRNA on ribosome. Okay. Now this is the initiation. Initiation includes the two ribosomal subunit mRNA parallel to the mRNA, and amino acyl tRNA taking particular amino acid parallel to it. GTP will catalytic activity. Initiation factors are there. We do not concentrate on the initiation factor now, but first see how they are working. This is a Shin-Dalgarno sequence. We have in a transcription, we have a Tata box. This is a Shin-Dalgarno sequence, same as a transcription. First concentrate on the AUG. AUG is a start codon. Okay, so protein synthesis is start from the AUG. But few base pair upstream to the AUG, there is a Shin-Dalgarno sequence. Shin-Dalgarno sequence, they will make a particular starting point so that the ribosomal subunit 16S, the small subunit and large subunit, they will attach to the particular mRNA with the Shin-Dalgarno sequence. Initiation codon. The AUG is the initiation codon in the eukaryotes. In a prokaryotes, there is a formal AUG is in the eukaryotes. It is recognized by the IF2 initiation factor. GTP is hydrolyzed to the GDP. And the end formal tetrahydrofolate is make the formal methionine tRNA. Okay. This is in a prokaryotes that the N-formyl AUG, N-formyl formyl methionine tRNA will form, and in eukaryotes there is a methionine tRNA will form. Ribosome assembles amino acid into the polypeptide. Here the back one is a big subunit, thus the below one is a small subunit, so that both large and a small subunit particular come to the mRNA according to a Sindalgano sequence, and there is a various site. The AUG is the initiation factor is there. So here there is a starting of the protein synthesis with the methionine tRNA, but this tRNA and the methionine which is there in the protein synthesis, the both tRNA are the different one. In prokaryotes, there is a formal methionine. Please make it sure that AUG, this is how the initiation factor will come, and that will make the initiation complex. Please concentrate how many things are there: initiation factor 1, initiation factor 3, and initiation factor 2. Initiation factor 1 and 3 will make the 30S subunit parallel to the mRNA. Here the formal methionine will come, and then the large subunit will come at that time when the 50S subunit will join. At that time the initiation factor will remove, and the 30S and 50S ribosomal subunit will join, and the starting with the formal methionine in prokaryotes. Here the same thing is that the below one is a small subunit, above one is a large subunit, and there are P and A site. This is still regarding the mRNA binding. That the 40S subunit, this is EIF. E means eukaryotic. If there is only IF, then initiation factor, it is in a prokaryotes. This is regarding eukaryotes, that eukaryotic initiation factor 2 will take 40S subunits parallel to the mRNA according to Sindalgano sequence. Okay, and that a small subunit will join to the large subunit later on. This large, the elongation initiation factor 2 removed, and the large subunit will join, and this will make the particular protein synthesis site. Okay. Now come to the elongation. Regarding elongation, please make, there are the three site: E site, P site, and the A site. E site is the first one, it shows the empty site. P site is a peptidyl site, and the A site is the acceptor, the new amino acid will come here. Okay. I have already told you, whenever you will read the translation, please first concentrate how the process will make. At that time, please do not concentrate on the initiation factor and the energy. When you read the second time, at that time, please concentrate only on the factors, initiation and elongation and the releasing factor. And when you read third time, at that time, please concentrate on the only energy one. So you can know easily, otherwise you may have some difficulty. In the elongation factor, various elongation factor are there in the eukaryotes, and in prokaryotes there are the different. Here the uncharged tRNA at the ribosomal E site. Here in our figure, first is a methionine is there. The second is phenylalanine is parallel to the mRNA. Amino acid tRNA will make the particular complex with the amino acid, and that amino acid tRNA activated will take a particular amino acid to the A site, so that phenylalanine and methionine are parallel, and this is already activated. They have the two phosphate bond, and this is the activated phenylalanine, so it is directly translocated, and there is a peptide bond formation between the methionine and the phenylalanine. So now there is a site is changed, and the P site is made to the phenylalanine. The protein is elongated on upside, methionine and peptide bond phenylalanine. Now it is going to be make the P site, and the tRNA which carries the methionine, it is released. It is inactive tRNA, it is going further ahead, so it is called as E site, empty site. Please make it sure that P site and A site, they are the transferable, they are not a static one. They are just imaginary, they are not a static one. Okay, so each time when the new amino acid will come, it will come to the A site. Once there is a peptide bond is formation between the new amino acid and the old protein polypeptide chain, At that time, the P site is moved to the new amino acid and the remaining tRNA is called as E1. Here, already the methionine tRNA, it is initially at the P site, but in the last figure, it is converted into empty site. Okay? This is a peptide bond formation. This is an elongation. The first one is a methionine. In a methionine associated with the new amino acid and it is already activated. So, there is a peptide bond formation. When there is a translocation, at that time one GTP is used. But here the already activated amino acid, so peptide bond is formed. And it is the peptide bond formation is a condensation result in the release of water by the enzyme peptidyl transferase. And it is discovered that the peptidyl transferase is a catalytic RNA molecule. It is called as a ribozyme. This is the same elongation factor, but here the figure is with the elongation factor 1 and 2. Initially, the new acceptor amino acid, the new amino acid come to the A site with the elongation factor 1 and the P site with the elongation factor 2. Okay? When there is a translocase, at that time, the elongation factor bulk is complete. This is the protein synthesis, that initiation, elongation. This is the elongation, growing peptide chain. Okay? Finally, when there is a protein synthesis is completed, at that time, when there is a stop signal, at that time, the both large and subunit, they are completely divided, they are removed and the polypeptide chain is completed, the formation is completed. Now come to the termination. In a termination, we have already discussed there are the stop codon are there, UAA, UAG and the UGA, but please make it sure that selenocysteine and pyrrolocysteine, they are the amino acid 21 and 22 and selenocysteine is with a particular code UGA and the pyrrolocysteine with the UAG. Here, whenever there is a stop codon is there, at that time the releasing factor will bind here. Now, please see in this figure, the first one, at the particular site when the protein synthesis is completed, at that time there is a stop codon are there, UAG, UGA and UAA. The releasing factor will come and join to the particular stop codon, okay, and there, at that time, no further tRNA will come. So, the last tRNA which have the polypeptide chain, they will release the chain and that tRNA is going to the empty now without the amino acid. It is a free tRNA as in a second figure and finally, that the polypeptide chain is released, the large and small subunit is released and the releasing factor are released. So, all the machinery of the releasing factor are released. Now, this is the important that how many, I have already completed the basic, the translation process, okay, and please, in initiation, if there is a prokaryotic, then initiation factor 1, 2 and 3 is there. If there is a eukaryotic, then E initiation factor 1, EIF1, EIF2, EIF4, they are there. In an elongation, there is an EF. Elongation factor 1, elongation factor 2 are there. But, and in a releasing factor, there is a RF, releasing factor 1, releasing factor 2, releasing factor 3. They are there. They are different in the prokaryote and the eukaryote, but the basic name are the same. Now, this is regarding ATP. First, when you read the whole, when you understand the translation process, when you understand the initiation and elongation, then please concentrate on the ATP. First, amino acid tRNA activation will make the 2-ATP, ATP to AMP formation, and there is a finally formation of amino acyl tRNA complex. Second, the elongation factor when it comes to the A site, at that time it used the 1 GTP. Third, the translocation, once there is a peptide bond formation is there and the whole the protein is come to the A site and the A site is converted to into P site, in that translocation there is a 1 GTP formation. So if there is a total 10 polypeptide is there and 10 amino acid will make the polypeptide and 10 amino acid, then 10 into 4 means 40 ATP has been used. In eukaryotes, in the initiation, when the initiation factor will join and large and small subunit is joined, at that time 1 ATP and 1 GTP has been used, and for termination releasing factor 1 GTP again is used with the releasing factor. So if the 10 amino acid polypeptide chain in eukaryotes, then total 43 ATP has been used. Okay, the initiation and termination, they are used only for once. They are not with each and every amino acid. So make it clear, there are 40 ATP plus 3 ATP, so there are 43 ATPs are used. Now, as like always, whenever you complete any biochemical cycle, you read each and every step in detail. But finally, in an exam, we are asking the last one. Either there is a regulation of that cycle or the related disorder. Same way, this is an important topic regarding exam. This is a post-translational modification or post-translational processing. Here, please concentrate. The post-transcriptional is a different one and the post-translational is a different one. And please make it sure, till PG exam, till you get the admission in a PG, you must know the post-translational processing. Here, just like as in a post-transcriptional, there is a intron are removed, exon are joined, spliceosome are there, okay, 5-day capping, 3-day polyetaling, okay, same way, the basic protein synthesis has been completed. But now, for a requirement of particular protein, particular characteristic of protein, we will make the required changes. The first, the required changes is the proteolytic cleavage, like proinsulin to the insulin. Okay, when there is an insulin formation, then it is a useful. So, there is a proinsulin to the insulin formation. Second, the modification of amino acid. First, you can, the basic example is a collagen formation. In a collagen, for a stability, there is a glycine, hydroxylysine, hydroxyproline. Hydroxylysine and hydroxyproline are not the example, are not the particular amino acid. They are from the proline and lysine. So, hydroxyproline and hydroxylysine, they are the form by the post-translational modification. Same way, the gamma carboxylation of glutamic acid, as by the vitamin K dependent, it is helpful in a blood coagulation pathway. The hydroxylation of the proline and the lysine, the phosphorylation, glycolation, methylation of the histone, epigenetics, it is a part of epigenetics. These all are the important post-translational modification. The other process are the subunit aggregation, the hemoglobin, immunoglobulin, and the protein folding by the chaperones. Okay, so these all are most important for an exam point of view and for a PG exam entrance point of view. So please prepare the post-translational modification. The above is a proinsulin. The proinsulin will folded and there is a sulfur bond between the particular amino acid and the remaining insulin part is removed. It is called as a C-peptide. So proinsulin is converted in a mature insulin. This is the phosphorylation, glycosylation, hydroxylation. Phosphorylation includes the increase or the decrease activity of the serine, threonine, tyrosine. Glycosylation of the plasma membrane protein. Hydroxylation we have already told regarding collagen. Covalent modification by the biotin to the pyruvate carboxylation. They will attach to the epsilon amino group of the lysine. There the biotin dependent enzyme and carboxylation reaction are there. acetylation and methylation of the histone, phosphorylation, hydroxylation, carboxylation, glycosylation, biotinylation, biotin attach, it is called as biotinylation, farnesyl attach, it is called as farnesylated protein. Okay, farnesyl group is there, biotin group is there. This is all the post translational modification. Now this is again exam point of view, one of the most important thing. Whenever you complete the translation, you can think that we have know the each and everything. But in an exam, we are asking this one. The first is a Zellweger syndrome. Here there is a defective oxidation of the VLCFA, very long chain fatty acid. You know already the beta oxidation of fatty acid. Beta oxidation of fatty acid are for a long chain fatty acid. But which fatty acid which are more than 20 carbon, 24 carbon, they are in a very long chain fatty acid. So they in a peroxisome, they are going to the peroxisome. The peroxisome do not have, in Zellweger syndrome, there is a no peroxisome enzyme are there. The in normal person, the peroxisome enzyme will convert VLCFA, very long chain fatty acid, into the fatty acid, long chain fatty acid. And that long chain fatty acid is going to further for the beta oxidation of fatty acid. Okay, but peroxisome is required for very long chain to the long chain fatty acid conversion. Here peroxisome enzyme are absent. So in Zellweger syndrome, the very long chain fatty acid do not oxidize to the fatty long chain fatty acid. And VLCFA accumulated in a CNS and causing neurological impairment and death in a childhood. Another example is a primary hyperoxaluria. It is a glycine metabolism and maybe the part of the serine. The glyoxylate aminotransferase seen in a mitochondria instead of the normal peroxisomal location. Here the protein which make the particular glyoxylate aminotransferase enzyme, it is normally present in a mitochondria. But its place has been changed. And it is found in a mitochondria instead of the normal one in a peroxisome. The third one is a familial hypercholesterolemia due to the deficient transport signal. The fourth is an inclusion cell disease. Here the mannose-6-phosphate is on a particular degraded material and it will go to the lysosome. But mannose-6-phosphate, it is a one type of address on a particular degraded protein. But it is defective, so it cannot go to the lysosome, and eye cell disease is there. This is also the part of the post-translational modification. It is the chaperones and the related the protein folding disorder. The chaperones are the particular protein which are help in a folding of protein. Trimming, it is a part of the zymogen are activated in a activated enzyme, the pepsinogen to the pepsin, trypsinogen to the trypsin. This is called as a trimming. It is also the part of post-translational modification. Protein degradation by the ubiquitin. Covalent modification of the various enzyme by the phosphorylation and dephosphorylation from the glycogen synthase, glycogen phosphorylase, HMG co-reductase. They are active and inactive by the phosphorylation and the dephosphorylation. So please make it sure, please prepare the post-translational modification for our exam point and for the post-graduation purpose also. In a translation, regarding the translation process, just make it clear, please prepare what are the basic raw material required. Second, what are the initiation and elongation factor? Third, how many ATP and JTP are used? Okay, but after that, please prepare the post-translational modification. Now, there are the various antibiotics. They inhibit the particular translation process by the inhibiting particular raw material or the enzyme. These are the erythromycin, ribosomal inhibit the 50S subunit, clindamycin 50S subunit, tetracycline 30S subunit. Puromycin inhibit the amino acid tRNA, chloramphenicol inhibit the peptidyl transferase, diphtheria toxin inhibit the elongation factor 2 and it inhibit the translation. So these are the various inhibitor of the translation. Ricin. Ricin is a extremely toxic metabolite. It is isolated from a castor bean and inactivates the 20S ribosomal RNA by catalyzing the N-glycolytic cleavage of the removal signal adenine. So ricin is also the one of the important inhibitor of the translation. Here in a translation there is a fundi is there, the by at 30 and the cell at 50. By at 30 means 30S ribosome has been inhibited by the tetracycline and A for the aminoglycosides, and the cell at 50 CEFF, chloramphenicol, erythromycin, they will inhibit the 50S subunit. Now these are the various different type of RNA, microRNA or miRNA, interfering RNA or RNAi or siRNA, and principle of antisense therapy. This I will cover in the next lecture, but this is today we have completed the translation, post-translational modification, protein folding, and the inhibitors of the various antibiotics. So please prepare in the section of the translation. Thank you very much.